Dear students, in the current semester, we'll be looking at the subject Automation and PLC Programming, that is your elective number one. So, teaching scheme for this subject is 3 hours per week and one practical per week. So, we'll be starting with the lectures first, and then we'll be looking at the practicals also. So, the evaluation scheme for the subject is, as you know, that test number one is of 25 marks, test number two is of 25 marks. And semester end examination is of 100 marks. So total it will be 150 marks evaluation scheme is there. So for this subject we have designed certain outcomes. So the first outcome is related with the hardware of the PLC systems. So we have to describe working of various building blocks of the PLC system and their functions. So this outcome is related with the hardware of the system. The second outcome is related with the ladder programming. So till date the ladder programming is the most widely used programming languages for the PLCs. The second most popular programming language used for the PLC is functional block diagram. So we'll be looking for the fundamentals of PLC ladder programming. So this is our second outcome. The third outcome is we'll be learning the basics and advanced instructions used in the PLCs. The outcome is maintenance of the PLC based system. So we'll be troubleshooting the PLC based system and faults. So these are the outcomes of the course. In short, we'll be looking at the syllabus of the subject. So our unit number one is programmable logic controller introduction. So in that we'll be looking what is PLCs, what is the definition of the PLC, what are the different parts of the PLC systems, what is basic principle of operation of the PLCs, how we can modify the operation of the PLC. We'll be comparing PLC with the computers. We'll be looking at the PLC sizes, in what sizes they come, what a different classification of the PLC is available, how to select the PLC, so selection procedure of a PLC, that we'll be looking. Then what are the applications in which PLCs are used, what are the input output models available. So in this case, digital input output models and analog input output models and their specifications will be looking. So unit number two will be looking at the basics of PLC programming, and that will be looking at the memory organization. So memory organizations, in that there are different files are present, so such as program files, data files. Then very important aspect of PLC programming is program scan cycle. Then we'll be looking at the different programming languages used in PLCs. In all, 5 programming languages are used. Then we'll be looking at relay type instructions, instruction addressing. So every PLC has its own addressing methods. So Allen-Bradley PLC has a different addressing method. Mitsubishi PLC has a different addressing method. So we'll be looking at the addressing methods in detail. Then we'll be looking at the different instructions such as branch instructions, internal relay instructions, then examine if closed and examine if open instructions such as NO and NC instructions. The unit number three is related with the PLC wiring diagrams. So we'll be looking at the contactors, motor starters, how to connect these contactors and motor starter to the PLCs, output control devices, other output control devices, how can we that can be connected to the PLCs, sealing circuits, latching relays, converting relay schematics into PLC ladder program. So conventional relay logic that can be converted into PLC ladder program, writing a ladder program. So this is our unit number three. Unit number four is related to the timers and counters instruction in detail. So we'll be looking at the how to use timers, what are the different types of timers, what are the retentive timers, how to use timers in the PLC programs. Then in counter, we'll be looking at the how to use high speed counter, how to use encoder instructions, what are the applications of timers and counters, and writing of the programs for the timers and counters. Unit number 5 is related with the advanced instructions. So we'll be looking at mathematical instructions, jump control instructions, math instructions, data transfer instructions, sequencer instructions, shift instructions. We'll be looking at the different advanced instruction used in the PLC programming, And unit number 6 is related with the maintenance of the PLC based system. So that is, what is voltage variation, what do you mean by surge, what do you mean by grounding, how to identify the faults in the input model, how to identify the faults in the output model, how to identify the communication errors, what is the procedure for the preventive maintenance. That will be looking at the unit number 6. So there are certain reference books, so I personally recommend you that you should use the book Programmable Logic Controller, Frank D. Petrizzella, the McGraw-Hill publication book. I will share the soft copy of the book on the Teams. You can refer from there. Then the second book is Mechatronics, W. Bolton, Pearson edition. This is also a very good book. And the third book I recommend is Programmable Logic Controllers, Webb and Rice, PHR publication. So this is all about our syllabus. So we'll be starting our unit number 1, that is introduction to the programmable logic controller. So basically, programmable logic controller, or in short we can call it as a PLC, is a specialized computer used to control machines and processes. So PLCs are used for controlling the machines and processes. So if you go visit any industry such as textile industry, automobile industry, packaging industry, food industry, or process industries such as oil and gas industry, you'll find PLCs are preferred for the automation purposes. So if you have to do some automation, people will prefer the PLCs. Now we'll look at the definition of the PLC. So what is PLC? In simple words, PLC has a programmable memory. In that programmable memory, we'll be storing the instructions. Set of instruction is nothing but the program. So in a programmable memory, we'll be storing the program which will execute the specific functions. So what are those functions? That include the on-off control, timing, counting, sequencing, arithmetic, and data handling. So I will repeat it once again for you. So PLC has a programmable memory. In the programmable memory, we'll be storing the program which will execute specific functions such as on-off control. So turning on something, turning off something is called as on-off control. Timing control or timing function is nothing but turning on or off some output devices after some delay. This is called as a timing function. Counting number of jobs on the conveyor is called as a counting function. Sequencing means what? For a machine or for a process, there are certain steps to be followed, and this is called as a sequencing of the sequencing operation, or it is also called as a sequencing function. Arithmetic function means what? It must support addition, subtraction, multiplication, division, or trigonometric functions or matrix functions. So it is called the arithmetic functions. And data handling, copying data, manipulating data, processing data is called the data handling. So PLC supports all these functions such as on-off control, timing, counting, sequencing, arithmetic, and data handling. So this is the definition of the PLC. Now we'll look at some of the advantages of the PLC based system. What are the advantages of PLC control system? So we are looking at the advantages of PLC based system over conventional relay control circuits. So when there was no PLCs, where there no PLC were invented, all the automation was done using conventional relay control circuits. So it is very important. So what was the main drawback of the conventional control relay circuit is hard wiring. So I will read for you and I will explain. So PLC eliminates much of the hard wiring that was associated with the conventional relay control circuits. So whenever there is no PLC were there, all automation was done using conventional relay control circuits. So relays are used for automation purposes. Okay, so we'll take one example. So this is very complex example. So this is wiring diagram. So at first sight, you will see that it is very complex circuit diagram. So instead of going for this complex wiring diagram at this point, we'll be looking this wiring diagram after sub points. So for this, we'll take one simple example, which is very simple. So we'll look at how relays can be used for automation purposes. We'll take simple example how will relays can be used. So for this purpose, I will take one simple example. I have two push buttons. One push button is for start, another push button for stop, and I need one output as a lamp or motor. You can call it as a lamp or motor. For simplicity, we'll call it as a lamp. So start push button, stop push button, and lamp. So if I press the start push button, my lamp should be on. I don't do anything to the stop push button, so it will remain zero. If I release the start button, if I don't do anything to the stop button, my lamp should remain on. So it should be latched by the start button. So this is my requirement. Suppose I don't do anything to the start button, my lamp is already on. If I press the stop button, the immediately lamp should go off. If I don't do anything to the start button, if I release the stop button, the lamp should remain in off state. So this is my requirement. This is my requirement for the automation system. So I'm using two buttons, start button and stop push buttons, and one lamp is there. So if I press the start button, immediately the lamp will be on. If I release the start button, my lamp should be remained on. If I press the stop button, the lamp should be off, and if I release the stop button, it should remain in the off state. So this is my requirement of the system. So now how we can use relays to perform this operation? So everybody knows relays. So relay, what are the advantages of relay? The first advantage of relay is what? It provides isolation. And second advantage of relay is it offers two contacts. One is NO contact and second is NC contact. This is very important. It offers two contacts. So basically, what is the symbol of a relay? So everyone knows this is symbol of a relay. A This is common terminal of the relay. This is terminal is called as the NC terminal. This terminal is called as the NO terminal. These are the two terminals of the coil. So I will be connecting one push button at this terminal. This is my second terminal. So what happens if I press the push button? If I press the push button, the current will flow through this, current will flow through this coil. Magnetic field is generated and it will change this contact. So now common is connected to NC, now it will be connected to the NO terminal. So this is the operation how the relay operates. So the first advantage of relay is isolation. There is no direct contact between input and output, and so there is no contact between input and output. So the contact is through air. No direct contact between output device and input devices. So It offers isolation, so we can switch here higher voltages compared to this input section. Secondly, it offers two contacts. So one relay, one coil has two contact. One is NO contact and second is NC contact. So we can use these contacts for the automation purposes for interlocking. So these two contacts can be used for the interlocking purposes. Interlocking purposes. Right. So this is the operation of a relay. Now we have to draw a control system for this system. So I have written once again start push button, stop push button, and lamp. So this is our requirement. Then I press the start button. When I press the start button, my lamp should be on. If I release the start button, my lamp should remain on. If I press the stop button, my lamp should be off. If I release the stop button, my lamp should remain off. Okay, this process will be repeated once again. So I've drawn two relays, relay number one. I've drawn relay number two. I've drawn my lamp. Now, for this requirement, if I press the start button, my relay should be on. So if I press this, so I have connected plus over here. If I press the start button, my relay will be on. When my relay will be on means what? Common will be connected to the NO terminal. So now if I connect plus at the common terminal, if I connect plus to the common terminal and the relay is on, I will get common at the NO terminal. I will give this NO to the lamp. So my lamp will be on. But if I release the start button, what happens? This relay will be off again. This will be again open and I will not get the plus at this terminal, so it will go into off state. I don't want this because it should remain in the on state if I release the start button. So what should I do is I have to connect this terminal to the here. Now what happened? If I press the start button, relay will be on, this plus will be connected to the NO and your lamp will be on. Similarly, this terminal is connected to this, so here I will get plus. If I release the start button, this terminal already is having plus, so it is latched, so it will remain in on condition. So these two conditions are satisfied. So I've used NO contact to latch the relay. Now what is my second condition? If I press the stop button, my relay should go into the off state. Now if I press the stop button, nothing is happening in this case. So what should I do is I have to erase this and I have to connect this to the NC terminal, and at this terminal I need to connect the plus sign. So what I have done is if I press the stop button, it will open this contact, and at this terminal you will not get the plus sign, so it will go into the off state. So now if I press the stop button, this relay will be on, so this will be open. This open means what? No plus is going over here, so it will go into the off state. So understood. If I press the start button, my lamp is on and it will remain in the on state. If I press the stop button, it will go into the off state and it will remain into the off state. Once again, I don't press the start button. So this is the how we can use the relays or the control system. Now let us look at this circuit in detail. So this is having two inputs and one output system. Can you imagine if there are 100 inputs and 50 outputs, what will be happen to the circuit? So you can find lots of wiring is required for this. Okay, whether this is a reliable system? No, because if one wire is loose or some problem in the wiring is there, whole system will collapse. So this is not recommended. Again, can you troubleshoot the system with 100 inputs and 50 outputs? The troubleshooting in this case is very difficult. So it is another drawback. The next important thing is whether this system is reliable. No, because troubleshooting of this system will take more time. And if I want to modify the system, what will happen to the system? If I want to modify, I want 101 input and I want to add one more output, so 101 input and 51. Again, I need to change the whole wiring. So it is very time consuming process. Okay, so what is the solution for this? So whatever the logic here is present, it is present in the hard wiring. So we need to replace this logic of hard wiring into the software. Is it clear? So whatever logic is required, here the logic is present in terms of wiring, that logic has to be replaced in the software. So let us simulate this circuit in the Proteus software. So I have taken two push buttons, start push button, stop push button. I have taken two relays, relay number one, relay number two, and I have taken lamp. So this is common terminal of the relay, this is NC terminal, this is NO terminal. This is the common terminal of the relay, this is NC terminal, this is NO terminal. Now if I press the start button, what will happen? See, if I press the start button, so I have pressed the start button, this relay is on, so common will be connected to the NO terminal of the right node. So this common is connected to this, it is passed through this NC terminal. So NC is connected to the supply. So this supply will come through the common, then NC, then it will be given to the NO terminal. This will go to the lamp. So lamp is on now. Lamp is on. Same way, this is connected to the coil of the relay number one. So it is latched now. So if I release this button, due to this latched, this relay will be continuously on. So if I release this, still it is on. So there is no change in the relay because we have connected plus over here. So this relay is latched. Now what will happen if I press the stop button? This relay is operated. So this NC will connect to the NO terminal. So positive is whatever is getting through this path to the lamp, that will be broken. So if I press the stop button, see here, this path is open. So this relay is off. So the lamp is off. So if I release the stop button, it will remain in the off state. Unless and until I don't press the start push button, then the lamp will not get on. So if I release the start button, the lamp will be on. If I press the stop button, the same moment the lamp will be off. We can use relays for the interlocking purposes. So this is a simple system in which we have used relays to control the lamp as per our requirement. Now let us see what are the drawbacks of this. Our interlocking is done through the relays over here. So whatever logic, if the logic is complex, we require more number of relays in this. So is the logic complex, we need more and more number of relays. As the interlocking is more, interlocking is complex, we require more and more number of relays. Again, suppose there is a problem in the wire, so what will happen? Whole system will break down. And if the system is more complex, then it is difficult to identify the fault, so it is not a reliable system. Again, the installation time, designing time required for this is more. And again, if modifications are possible in the logic, no, if I want to change the logic of the system, that I need to change the whole the circuit, then only it is possible. So modification in the logic is not possible in this case. Troubleshooting is difficult. The system is not reliable, as one wire can completely break down the system. So what we have to do is we have to replace this hardware wiring or hardware logic into the software. So in PLCs, we have replaced all this interlocking into the software purposes.